Hey, Traxton. Not that much commitment. It's almost midnight. Felix, greetings. Greetings. Oh no. Yeah, we just started. I'm probably gonna go for at least an hour. Gonna go for maybe two or three. We'll see how it goes. I don't know what's up with my voice right now. Hey, Shay, greetings. Felix, I don't know if you're all about the Discord, but we have a Discord server. It's where you can chat when Twitch isn't up. There's voice chat if you're all about that, et cetera, et cetera. Ah, yes. Awesome. See you, Traxton. Oh no. They gathered in the dining hall for the year's end feast sometime later. The food had been laid out and was hidden beneath white sheets held up on wooden frames, concealing the meal from view. But the sheets could not mask the smell, which wafted through the hall and set every mouth to wafting. The instructor's table stood at the head of the hall. Zane sat in a place of honor with the sunny air. Once the hour struck, Zane stood and raised a goblet of wine. Everyone quieted, and he waited a moment in silence. When at last he spoke, his thick voice filled the room's every corner, thrumming in Evan's breast. This is time before time. He was in his medication for celebration. Since time before time, year's end has been an occasion for joy. We herald the passing of another year of our lives and the sky's bounty that has allowed our survival. But that celebration is always tempered by mourning. For we acknowledge those who have gone to the darkness below and thank them for their gifts in life. This year has given us more cause for mourning than most. Many have been lost and some greater than others. His next words cut short in a choking sound, and he bowed his head. The hall was deathly still. Evan, Theron, and Calum looked to each other uncertainly. The silence lasted only a moment, but when Zane raised his head, his cheeks were wet. Some give their lives that we might go on. Others give their lives that we might find redemption. They bring us back from the darkness that we stand on its brink. Oh, man, he's talking about Jordel. I forgot I wrote this. Still, others give their lives to time's natural sway, and then our mourning is not so bitter. But worst of all, those who are taken without reason, claimed by the madness of a sick mind, or by the treachery of the kingdom breaking its vows. Often we seek explanation. They are rarely. It is rarely to be found. We can only honor the dead who we shall never see again. Another pause. Evan heard many students in the hall sniffling while others sobbed openly. Zane raises goblet higher to those in the darkness. Every cup lifted to those in the darkness. They drank, and then the first course was brought round the tables. That evening's year's-end feast left nothing to be desired, fulfilling every wildest tale Evan had ever heard of the celebration splendor on the seat. Throughout each year, the academy had to serve hundreds of students three times a day. While the food was wholesome and hearty, it was rarely delicious. During year's end, it seemed the cooks aimed to make up for all the rest of the year's plain fare. There were fine roasts of meat of boar and beef and lamb, flavored with wonderful spices, served tender enough to fall off the bone. They were joined by crops from all across the Nine Lands, so that the students could find chickpea. Chickpea spread and figs from Idris, and then at the next table, buttered yams and yellow rice from Kalentin. In the center of the spread was a table filled to bursting with desserts, where honeyed confections of every type were piled high, and students were free to take what they wished. Wine was also served, although this was held by the cooks and only given to students who were old enough, and even then withheld if they thought a student had had too much. The last thing the academy needed was a drunken brawl with hundreds of young wizards who had yet to fully command their powers. Again and again, Evan went to the serving table, a lotus plate with more food, again and again, leaning back on his bench and clutching at his belly, afraid it would burst. At last, he gave up, leaning heavily on the table, sipping lightly at the last of his wine. Calum's head was nodding beside him, and across the table, Theron was licking honey from her fingers. "A particularly fine feast this year," she said, and gave a loud belch. "I will not say it is the finest food I have ever eaten, yet I would count this as my favorite meal," said Evan. "Rarely in my life have I been able to take such a meal with friends, rather than a father who made my life a torment." Said Calum, looking at them sleepily. "Ah, yes, a fine feast indeed." Theron chuckled and shook her head, but then Evan felt a hand on his shoulder and looked up to find Dasko looking down upon him. "Well met, Evan. Have you enjoyed your feast?" "Good eve, Evan. Have you enjoyed your feast?" Evan nodded. "Very much so, Instructor. I hope you have as well." "Indeed. Might we still take that walk as I requested?" "Of course." Evan stood, but then looked to his friends. Theron waved him off. "Go, I should get this one to bed." She pointed to Calum, who seemed in danger of falling asleep and drowning in buttered yams. "Good night then," said Evan. "I will see you upon the morrow." And he set off through the dining hall after Dasko. Dasko led him through the hallways and through and out a white cedar door into the training grounds. The moons lit the night well, and torches mounted along the citadel's walls helped them pick their way along the... in the garden path. The instructor did not speak immediately, but let the night silence rest, occasionally looking up at the stars as they shone bright in the sky. Hey, Carl, what's up? Long time no see. Oh, I know you'll be interested in the Discord server. We have a Discord server now set up by Alex, a.k.a. Draconic Rose. It's available for text chat when I'm not streaming, or when I am streaming, but also voice chat if you want to hang out with people. "I've only been an instructor here for a few years," Dasko said at last. "I studied here in my youth, of course, but that was long ago. I feel as though I have been rediscovering the place anew. It is certainly a different experience being an instructor." Evan blinked and then frowned. "I imagine it would be," Dasko sighed. "My apologies. I am not certain how to say what I mean, and so I prattle about inconsequential things. That and not my preoccupation with Lilith's crimes has been what kept me from speaking with you before today." He stopped and Evan halted beside him. Again, Dasko looked up at the stars, his jaw working. "Before I returned to the academy, I was a mercenary," he finally said, his voice so soft that Evan leaned closer to hear it. "I fought for a sellsword army that marched across the Nine Lands. We served with many great families, both merchant and noble, and in one campaign I served your family, the Draydens. That is when I met your brother." Evan felt as though someone had struck him in the gut. He had scarcely thought of Mommen since first he came to the academy. Indeed, ever since his death, death years ago, Evan had tried to avoid thinking. At all. He felt suddenly lightheaded. Maman and I became fast friends after our first battle together, Daska went on. When you came to the academy, I hardly noticed you, though sometimes a thought tickled my mind. Then, after the attack on the seat, Gia was frantic because you had been separated from the rest of the students. Though we eventually found you, that was when the... Her mention of your name was what let the pieces finally fall into... Fall. Evan of the family, Drayden, younger brother of my friend Mammon. During all the time we served together, he would speak of you more often than anything else. A gasp escaped before Evan could stop it. His eyes burned, and he turned... swiping at them at the back of his sleeve. The air felt suddenly frozen, and he raised his hood against it. Daska took his shoulder gently, guided him toward a stone bench. Evan sank onto it, hiding his face in his hands and trying to master himself. "I'm sorry to resurrect grief," Daska murmured. "I did not mean to bring sadness, but advice." "What advice?" said Evan, no longer caring at how his voice broke. He found himself growing angry with Daska, angry that the man would presume to speak of his brother, who he could not have known half so well as Evan. "Before Dean Cyrus fled the academy, it seems that you and he have little love for each other," he said. Through his grief, Evan's heart skipped a beat. What did Cyrus have to do with anything? He was not over fond of me, no. Daska looked him in the eye. "Was that because of some personal disagreement between the two of you, or because of some more general schism between you and the family, Drayden?" Evan shrugged and looked away. "I know not what you speak of." "I think you do," said Daska. Mammon also felt the same way, never comfortable in the company of his family, and always burdened by their reputation, which, as you know, is fearsome. Always he wanted to cast off their name, and something tells me that you may... be similar. Discord is great. I get to play some Heroes of the Storm with Kristen and Rob tonight. It was a good time. Though he would have been loath to admit it, a thrill trickled through Evan's heart. He had never known Mom and had felt the same way about their family. "Even if that were true, what do you expect me to do? I was born Drayden, I will die Drayden. Yet you need not live your life under the suspicion of others. You must know that Dean Zane thinks ill of you, for no other reason than your last name, than your family's name. I know it cannot be easy to shed that shadow when everyone you meet can see only the darkness it wraps around you. What can I do about that? In truth, I'm used to it. I have little choice but to duck my head and hope to go unnoticed." Yeah. I don't really have time for games, but I was just like, you know... I'm going to take a quick break, bang out a couple of games of Heroes of the Storm, and that's what I did. "But you have been noticed, Evan," said Daska, leaning forward. "Zane does not wish to admit it, but the other faculty know you suspected Lilith from the first, and you may have helped expose her earlier than she would have been otherwise. Soon the mystics will have wheedled the artifacts out of her. Because of you, the Academy now takes steps to ensure the artifacts will be safer in the future. You should be proud of that, at least." "Pride in myself helps nothing, certainly not Zane's view of me. That is what I mean to say. You have helped, whether he sees it or not. Continue to do right, not in the hope that Zane will love you. Your kin have wounded him, and that sore may never heal." But do it because of the people you may help along the way. That, I think, is what Mammon would do. Evan stood from the bench, glaring at him. "That is too far. I'm sorry," said Daska, standing and bowing his head. "You were right, I presume too much. Yet I only say what Mammon often told me." that he wished to return home and help you, for a new life with your father would be harder once he had gone. Though he held his scowl, Eben found some of his anger dampen. Mommy could not have known just how true his words would prove. He turned away from Dasko, loosing a breath into mist in the frigid air.
Yeah, maybe. You said they have not drawn.
He had drawn the tooth from Lilith. I had not thought it would take this long to find the artifact she stole. Turned away from Dasko, loosing a breath into mist upon the frigid air, and steered the conversation in another direction, hoping to ease the burning in his heart. You said they have not yet drawn the truth from Lilith. I had not thought it would take this long to find the artifacts she stole, especially the second time, for she did not have much time to hide them. Dasko shrugged. She must have worked quickly. It will not be long. The mystics are very persuasive when they wish to be. Will they kill her? Not the mystics, no, said Dasko softly. But once they have recovered the artifacts, they will turn her over to the constables, who were put her to death under the king's law. And there might vanish any hope of learning Lilith's link to Mitami or Shay. Eben ground his teeth in frustration. It seemed that she would suffer for her crimes, but that the conspirators behind her, and he was sure such conspirators existed, would escape, for no one seemed to be looking for them. Yet, mayhap if Eben could speak to her, his heart raced. What excuse could he invent? No one would believe he and Lilith had ever been friends, but there was Nella. Ever since the attack on the seat, she and Eben had been, if not friendly, at least cordial. Yes, it might work. He turned back to Dasko. I wonder. I know her crimes are terrible, and Lilith and I had a grudge from the moment I arrived here. Yet there are those who never had the chance to say farewell, and if Lilith will never be returning, it seems cruel to deny them that opportunity. I am close to one who is dear to her. Dasko nodded. This just became an entirely different book. Theron, I know. Eben balked. Theron, how could Dasko ever think Theron and Lilith were friends? Yet the certainty in the instructor's eyes was unmistakable. Eben nodded and quickly continued, just so. Could it be arranged, do you think, for us to visit Lilith? I wish for my own sort of peace with her, and I know Theron desires the same. The instructor frowned. I do not know if that would be wise, Eben. For one thing, she will not be the same as last you saw her. The mystics are never kind to their prisoners, and they will likely be reluctant to ever speak with any outsider. I know your character, but they will not. Please, Dasko, Eben begged. Help me with this, so that this chapter of our lives may be left behind us. I promise we will urge Lilith to tell them what she knows. And the sight of a friendly face may pry loose what the blades of the mystics cannot. Dasko's frown deepened, but he looked away and thought before nodding. Very well, I will see if I can arrange something with G if it is that important to you, and perhaps as some token of payment for the ill will you have. Which you did not deserve. Thank you, Instructor. Given the chance, I promise I shall not waste it. I believe you, said Dasko, losing himself to... Nope. And now let us return to the Citadel. I am not yet an old man, yet I find myself less resistant to the chill than I was in my youth. They made their way back to the Academy and then parted inside, off to their beds. But Evan lay awake for a long while, thinking of Momin and Lilith and Theron. Yay, done chapter! It was a pretty fast chapter, actually. Kind of like working that way. Well, we've done two chapters so far. Damn, Daniel. Back at it again with the white vans. The next day, Evan wanted to tell them. Gonna refill my coffee real quick. Be right back. Awesome, Carl. Thanks for coming by. Good to see you. What do we say? One more chapter? Yeah, one more chapter. Oh, this is a long one. That's not that long. All right. Let's do it. Hello, Edward, my name. Yeah, honestly, they're a little bit more intensive than they should be. Sean and I are still going through growing pains as we work together, and this is actually the last book where he's going to be doing line editing and whatnot. Because we just haven't been able to figure out... we haven't been able to figure out a way that he can do line edits without changing my voice, which is the one thing that I didn't want to have happen. So in future books, I'm going to be doing my own second draft. And then the book's going to be going to Karen for editing. You must understand that the mystics questioners take no pleasure in what they have put Lilith through, nor in the further action they must take if you fail. Are you for real? No. Theron started when Evan at last put a hand on her arm. I am on page 157 of 224. So what is that? A little over two-thirds of the way through. Is that right? Yeah, that's right. Okay, that is done. And boy, do I need to go to bed. Oh, man. Okay, we're going to try and burn through the rest of this tomorrow. We'll see how that goes. Thanks so much for coming and hanging out, Shay. And Carl as well. Edward, my name. And earlier, Traxton, Felix, good to see y'all. Oh my God. We're so close to being done with this book. I want it to be done. I want it to be done and published and out there. Do, 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 do. Do, 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 do. Okay. That's going to be it. A couple of milestones recently. We passed 3,000 likes on the Facebook page. We passed 6,000 signups for the email list. Both of those are really friggin' awesome. We passed 400 pre-orders on The Mind Mage's Wrath, this book that we're working on right now. And yeah, that's crazy because we haven't even emailed our list about it. So I'm just like, okay, woo. So that's what's going on. We are going to get this book. Oh my God, this book is so fucking close to being done. It's disgusting. And yeah. Ah. Yay. Yeah, those are good numbers. Good numbers. We're gonna, like, a week from today being Tuesday, 1:30 a.m., we're gonna email several thousand people and tell them to pre-order the book. And I'm just kind of like, I don't know what's gonna happen. I can't wait. It's gonna be amazing. So, yay for all that. All right. Thanks again for coming and hanging out. I gotta get myself to bed, and I will catch you another time. Bye.